Shall I proceed?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Today's agenda towards decision making and data modeling, the essential foundation, essential elements or foundation elements are descriptive statistics, inferential statistics. So we'll be touching upon these two foundations, the mathematical foundations, complete stepping stone towards data analytics, or name it, you want to be a deep learning specialist or machine learning specialist, we may need to be thorough on these are all the two intricacies or mathematical phenomena. Followed by, we'll be moving on to Python introduction using Google Colab. First, we may need to understand what is data. It's a lowest level of abstraction. Just because of data, we may not be able to understand anything unless otherwise the description is given or inferences are taken out of the data. Data can be number. Data can be numbers, words, measurements, observations. These are all the elements can constitute a data. You can look at data a bit later after the slide, how data looks like in the CSV sheet or Excel sheet. Data can be pulled for analytics from various sources, either in the form of Excel or in the form of text file. Text file, all the information separated by comma or space or any special delimiter. For example, here I'm using delimiter to segregate two words with the comma, whereas here I'm using a delimiter space to segregate the words can and be. It's like that. So the text file will have a segregators to distinguish two different elements, or else the file could be CSV file, comma separated view. All the data in a row will be in the form of comma. The next row will be formed with again the observation in terms of comma. So this is called data. Data is representation of a fact, figure, or an idea. When it comes to vision, deep learning, this deep learning, what is the sense deep learning is? Deep learning is hungry of data, greed of data. It will start consuming a lot of data for the inferences. If the data fed to the neural network is lesser in quantity, then may not be able to do anything with the neural network. That's a subtle difference between machine learning and deep learning. So whatever we are doing with artificial intelligence, we are working on data. So even figure, a fact, could be a data. Data on its own carries no meaning. The moment if I say 45, it doesn't carry any meaning. The moment if I say ABCD, it doesn't carry any meaning. The moment I say 5, it doesn't mean anything. That 45 could be mark of a student, 45 could be age of a person, 45 could be penalty or fine value, 45 could be electricity bill value, but that number alone will not give any meaning. If we want to give meaning to the data, we need to get associated with attributes or row and column observation, or else the description, or else the person must be versatile in the business domain. Which domain? Whether the person is, the data comes from agricultural domain, or the data comes from business domain, or the data comes from educational domain, or the data comes from financial domain, depending upon the domain of the data gatheration or collection, it brings a meaning for it. Now let us see one simple example for data, how it looks. This is a data file. It's a data sheet or data file. It's in the form of CSV. If you look at each and every column, a column is said to be a feature or a variable or an attribute. Similarly, B column is said to be a feature or a variable or an attribute. The moment we flip towards the row, each row is said to be an observation or instance. Similarly, we need to count the entire rows and columns the moment we look at the data for the analytics. When we look into machine learning algorithm, the first phenomena, first concept is we may need to understand each and every attribute of the data each and every observation of the data, what it signifies. This number alone, 20 alone, may not be able to give any meaning for us. But if we go through the description of each and every attribute, we will come to know what exactly it is. So this is called data. This data representation right now in the form of CSV, when we really work in the real-time application, the data could be a SQL file, or data could be a big data, or in-memory data, or the data could be given in the form of text file, or the data, it could be given in the form of Excel file. The sources of data, we may not able to predict, but perhaps every data scientist should be able to good enough in reading all the format of data, which is given for the analytical job. So this is a way to introduce how the data looks like, how data is represented in a form. Now let's go back to the PPT. Suma, is it comfortable? Are you comfortable in viewing my PPT?
Yeah, I can view your PPT, but your voice is so low. I mean,
my number volume yesterday.
It's already 100, my volume, laptop volume.
But mine is also 100.
Okay.
Yeah. Or else, shall I do one small thing? Shall I change my system to one more laptop? Now, is it audible?
Yeah, it's audible. Okay, fine. No problem, because there are other people also logging. No problem.
Okay.
No, actually, Lakshmi, your voice is very clear, loud. Okay. Probably Suma's speaker is not kept at high.
Or else you can use headset, something like that, so that it will be...
Yeah. Actually, yeah, fine.
Yeah. Right now, the data set which I have shown in the form of Excel, it's a raw data table. Nothing is inferred out of that data. I haven't done any pre-processing. I haven't done anything. The data is pulled out from the internet. So I'm showing the data what as such. So initially the data is said to be a raw data, or it can be treated as a file or table. It's a collection of random information. Sometimes data may be missing. Sometimes data may be misleading. Sometimes unwanted data may be sitting in the file. But being a data scientist, we need to understand the problem statement or the domain, what really the vendor expects, what we may need to infer. Depending upon it, we may need to tune the raw data table suitable for the analytics. This is what very predominant or essential step when we approach data analysis. Generally, when we look at the data, we may need to able to understand what are all the variables, what are all the features, what are all the attributes are included, what information are we getting out of that data, what is the format of the variable, whether it is string or it is numerical, what type of variables, it is categorical, continuous and discrete. I will be touching upon once again what is categorical, what is continuous, what is discrete, but we may need to able to first question ourselves. Not limited to these four questions, much more, but it is very rudimentary. These four questions, rudimentary level, every data scientist need to raise within themselves. Is this data is representing sample or it represents population? What is sample and the population is also we will be discussing after a couple of slides. But we may need to raise such kind of questions around the given data set for the analytics process. Perhaps in the Excel file which I shared, I was labeling each column is said to be variable, feature or attribute. So we must able to understand what kind of variable it is or what it signifies, what is relevant to our problem statement, whether that attribute or that column need to be retained or need to be eliminated. These are all the introspection we may need to do when the data set is given initially. Now let's go back to data type. The second question perhaps I'm addressing right now. What is the format of the variable? For this question, we'll be moving on to the variable. A variable can be of either discrete data type or continuous data type. Underneath discrete, it could be nominal data type or ordinal data type. What each and every data signifies? perhaps any article we starts reading, these are all the words will revolve around that documentation. So variable or attribute or a column, that if it is of discrete data type, nominal. Nominal always will have name. The NN, you can match it. For example, nominal data type, we can start giving blood group, or we can start giving good, average, excellent, something like that. Then ordinal data type, it will be ordered, 1 to 5 scaling, 1 to 10 scaling, it will be ordered. Or shoe size, it will be ordered. First 1 inch, 2 inch, 3 inch, something. These all ordered data set. Categorical, again, we can come back to categorical data type. Favorite color, place of birth, types of car, these all said to be categorical. Sometimes categorical will be numeric. For example, category 1, I am grouping set of items into category 1. Then in that column, if it is represented as 1, it doesn't mean that it is numeric. It may lead to categorical also. We may need to be careful in understanding the data set before building the model itself. The moment we convert categorical into numerical, it will be a problem. For example, we are telling medium size, larger size, XL, double XL, something like that. I mean to say, in my computer world, the medium size of the shirt as 1, large size of the shirt as 2, XL size of the shirt as 3. The moment we look at it is in terms of numerical 1, 2, 3, we should not interpret that it is a numerical data type. It is of categorical data type. That is where the description of the data or understanding the business domain on which data we are working on, whether the data is coming out of IoT or agriculture or business or financial sector, something like that, we may need to undergo very deeply to understand about the nature of the data. Again, quantitative data will be of two types: discrete data, continuous data. Continuous data will be in the form of dot representation, or it will have the range from 1 to something. Mark of a student or entire class is graded with some mark. Normally or in general globally, mark lies between 0 to 100. We have boundary. But there are certain domain, for example, getting a loan, sanction of loan. There is no limit. Depending upon your salary, loan will be sanctioned. Loan may be sanctioned for 10,000 or 5,000 or 1 crore or 25 crores or 1 million, 1 billion. It's a range. There we cannot fix the boundary. This is said to be continuous data. We cannot fix the boundary of that. It varies from person to person, the sanctioning of the loan. These are all the basic understanding we may need to gain towards nature of the data, type of the data, because the nature of the attribute plays a vital role in treating or in handling towards data building or data model building. Now, how the data is considered for analytics or for machine learning? First, we may need to understand what is the nature of data. Immediately, we may need to marry with statistics. Statistics is a science. It involves right from collecting the data, organizing the data, presenting the data, analyzing the data, and interpreting the obtained result. And upon the result, we may need to take effective decision. Once we apply statistical tools or machine learning tools, the output would be 38.5, 45.5. But what that signifies, 38.5, what it means, 45.5, what it means, finally, we may need to able to interpret the numerical value obtained out of that model building with our business application. We may need to take decision. Final, that is data storytelling. Ultimately, data analyst or data scientist may able to put forth all the inferences taken out of the data, all the analytical process in terms of business language. That is the powerful skill set. Again, data scientists may be recovered during their profession or their journey. The inference of the result would be in terms of numerical or whatever, the number, or it could be anything. But that number, how it plays a role towards the business decision making, how that helps, So that is where the end of data analyst stops. Every data scientist must be able to collect the data in varied formats of the data, able to organize the data, able to present, able to analyze. That analysis could be visual analytic or numerical analytic or machine learning analysis, any kind of analysis we can apply. Then once analysis is done, we must able to interpret the results obtained out of the analysis. Then we may need to put forth or assist the business vendors for decision making. These are all the stages we may need to undergo. Again, the moment we step into statistics, broadly classified into descriptive statistic, inferential statistic. What is all about descriptive statistic? It's a kind of summarizing. It's a kind of understanding the nature of one particular situation. For instance, I'm running a business of fashion clothes. Maybe only women's wear I'm running. Today, what is the sales? What is my stock balance? What is my profit? What is my loss? If I am analyzing only about today's scenario, then it's termed as descriptive statistics. I'm able to find out the mean, or I'm able to find out the highest sale of today. Who is the customer purchased the highest price of clothes today? And who is the customer purchased the least price of the cloth today? Or what is the type of cloth I sold out today? Which item sold out more? If I start inferring such kind of questions only for the today's business matter, then it's termed as descriptive statistics. It could be graphical representation. I can put a bar graph. Today, saris sales goes to 1,000 pieces. Whereas when we go for kurtis, it is about only 10 pieces today. Something like that I can represent with bar graph. Whatever we do, it is restricted to one particular or confined nature of inferences that's said to be descriptive. It starts describing about today's situation. When I look at the data, we may need to able to articulate about today's scenario. That is called descriptive statistics. The moment we come to inferential statistics, we are doing or we are analyzing upon certain data, then we will be concluding something. That conclusion is applicable for the entire population. For example, being a woman starts cooking, we may not able to taste the entire food which we are cooking. We may be sampling it with one spoon or few drops of something, whatever we cook. Out of that taste, when perhaps we may be tasting only one spoon, out of that we will be concluding today's taste is so and so, or there is a reduction of salt, there is excess of salt, there is excess of spicy, there is excess of something. We can able to deduce. So that is called inferential statistic. For example, I will be conducting extensive research on administering certain drug for cancer patient. How it works? It may work positively or it may work negatively for 10 number of patients. Out of my research towards longitudinal research of 6 months, then I can conclude that the same medication will work upon all the cancer patients across the globe in the same manner. That is called inferential statistic. We will be taking a sample, we'll be working on a sample. What we are inferring out of that sample is applicable to the entire population is said to be inferential statistic. It will be true for future endeavors also if same situation exists. The moment scenario changes, we may not be able to infer the same, but if it sails with the same situation, we can infer or we can deduce to the population. Then inferential statistic, how we will be taking it forward. We will be discussing each and everything with a little bit use cases in the forthcoming slide. And inferential statistic has two major roles: estimation, hypothesis testing. Again, estimation classified into point estimation, interval estimation. What all about these are? It's a just introduction slide. Let's move to descriptive statistic. If you look at this case, we are taking a polling with a lot of members 49% of the people in a survey knew the name of the first book of the Bible. What that signifies, 49? Every 100 member, if we consider, out of 100, 45 members known about Bible. That is a description given by this particular analysis. The moment we represent 49, 49 members know about Bible. Out of every 100 member. Here, another way we are trying to describe. According to customer reports, General Electric washing machine owners reported 9 problems per 100 machines. 9% if we represent. Whatever the manufacturer starts selling the goods, out of 100 goods, every 9 item seems to be failure. So this description, how we are obtaining, again, it requires a lot of data analysis. We may need to find a survey. We may need to speak to the customer, how the goods working within the warranty period, and how many are reporting back it's not doing well, how many are reporting back it's going well, or how many complaints we receive between the sales duration 2001 to 2002. Based on that all data, we will be taking the inference. But anything confined to one particular situation, that is said to be descriptive. It doesn't mean that there are 2 washing machines. You may know Wipro also has washing machine. You may know what else washing machine. Samsung also has washing machine. It cannot be concluded the failure rate of Samsung to Wipro. We may not be able to conclude failure rate of Samsung to Tata. It all varies. It is descriptive about one particular vendor. If you are finding 9 pieces deficit with Samsung, it is applicable for only Samsung manufacturers. So we cannot deduce, we cannot infer that there are 9 Samsung washing machines are failure. Because of that, then 9 more IFB washing machines are failure. We cannot deduce that. So that is called descriptive. About that particular vendor, that particular situation, within that particular model, within that particular year, we will be analyzing something, we will be concluding something. That is said to be descriptive statistics. When it comes to inferential statistic, population, larger size population, we will be drawing some set of samples. Out of that sample, we will be working around. Then whatever the conclusion we obtain, that we are trying to apply to the population. That is called inferential statistics. The best example which I said, I'm trying to find out a new drug out of some herbal medicine for lung cancer. The entire world, if we consider, there may be 1 lakh or 1 million lung patients are there. I may not able to meet that 1 million patients across the globe. The person who are all nearby my locality, nearby country, I'll be pulling out 10 to 20 patients, lung cancer patient. I'm administering my drug. It works well, fantastic. 90% of the time it works well, or 90% of their symptoms are cured. Then what I am trying to infer out of that drug administration, I'm applying to the entire population that anyone consumes this medicine, naturally they'll be cured up to 90% out of their symptom. That is called inferential statistics. Whatever we are deducing out of that sample data, that inferences we can apply to the entire population. Again, see, for example, wine tasters sip a few drops of wine to make a decision with respect to all the wine waiting to be released for sale. They may not be able to consume the entire bottle. They may be able to test with few drops. Then they will be concluding with that taste or with that situation. This is called inferential statistics. Again, we are coming back to what is inferential treatment. Here we are considering different topic: dependent variable, independent variable. Treatment with active medication. Perhaps just a few minutes back I was quoting lung cancer. I'm giving some newly invented medicine or active medication. Treatment with placebo inactive medicine, that is called pseudo medicine, placebo medicine people used to call. Pseudo medicine, in the sense, we will be considering 2 different groups of the same symptom or same kind of patient, lung cancer patients, I'm considering. I'm grouping them into 20 patients into two different groups, group A, group B. Then I'll be administering the real medicine, which I recently discovered. There will be pseudo medicine administered for the group B. What is the pseudo medicine in the sense? They will not give any real medication. They will be filling with rice flour, some edible item, eatable item. They will be giving as a medicine just to treat them on equal ground. They will be giving. Then they will be observing. Is there any change with this patient, or is there any change with this patient? Is there any response, or there is a negative response, or there is a positive response, whatever may be. What we are trying to obtain after the treatment is called dependent variable. The dependency, the result of the patient is dependent on either this category or this category. Then these two variables are said to be independent variable. This is called dependent variable. If not with this case, we may need to understand with this case. These three columns or attributes are said to be independent. For example, column A states name of the country, column B states age of the person or age, simply age. Column C stands for their salary. Looking at these three instances, what is the target variable or dependent variable is whether this person is purchased today something with my shop, online shop or not. Although this person drawing salary 72,000, there is no purchase happened. When we look at the country is Spain, age of the person is 27, the salary the person draws is 48,000, but he purchases something with my shop. Whereas third instance, either it can be called as instance or row or observation. The country is Germany, age of the person is 30, drawing salary 54,000, he also doesn't purchase anything. This purchase is dependent on these three factors: country of the person, age of the person, salary of the person. Anybody starts purchasing, there is an influence of the country, or there is an influence of an age, or there is an influence of salary. If the person doesn't purchase also, there is an influence of country, there is an influence of age, there is an influence of salary. This is called dependent. This purchase is dependent on country of the person, age of the person, salary of the person. That's why it's called independent variable. These three are termed as independent variable, whereas column D is said to be dependent variable. One more terminology, target variable also people used to call. Another way also people used to call X variable, A, B, C, or country, age, salary. These three are said to be X variable, whereas purchase is said to be Y variable. Target, dependent, or Y variable, all are termed to be the same. For example, otherwise it's called Y variable, otherwise it's called target variable, otherwise it's called dependent variable. This D alone, we will be using this many representation: target, Y, or dependent. Whereas A, B, C, or country, age, salary, these all are said to be X. Suman, may I proceed further? Do you have any questions so far now? Types of data?
No.
Independent. Two major category of statistics, descriptive and inference.
Yeah. Statistics, variable, and data.
Yeah. Types of variables.
Yeah.
Types of statistics. Yeah. Types of data. These are the three topics we have covered so far now. Now we are slightly moving towards, yesterday I touched upon algorithm. How we may need to understand which model we need to use, which model we should not use. Just a minute, give me. Just now we have seen country, age, salary. All those three are said to be independent variable. Purchased is said to be dependent variable. If we look at the target variable or dependent variable, it's all of nature called categorical. either it is yes or no, or else I can flip in this way. I can represent no as one, yes as two. It's, although it is numerically represented one and two, it's also treated as a class, a category. This, whenever the target variable, dependent variable, what all machine learning going to do? For example, being a human, if you look at the country from France, 44 age, 72,000, there is no purchase happened. Then we may need to look at one more person from France also, whereas age is 48, salary is much higher than this person. He started purchasing. We started learning something out of this. It signifies that we cannot conclude that all the France people will not purchase items with me. Yes, there is a person from France starts purchasing with me. But what is the difference? The person age is 44 and 72,000. He is not purchasing with maybe dollar or rupees, whatever. When we look at France 11th row, ninth row, 48 age, 79,000 is drawing salary. He tend to purchase. There is one more instance. France, 37 years age, 67,000 is drawing salary. He do purchases. So just we are considering only the France case. Out of this, what we are trying to understand or infer being a human being. Number one, we cannot conclude looking at country alone, whether that person will purchase with me or not. Number two, we cannot consider only the age alone. Depending upon the age, I may not able to conclude whether that person will purchase with me or not. Number three, looking at salary alone, I may not able to conclude whether that person will purchase or not. But there is an intricacy or there is an undercurrent among all the three variables that leads to whether that person is purchasing or not. This interconnectivity among these three is taken care by machine learning algorithm. We being a human, if there is a consistency, we may able to predict absolutely. But machine learning algorithm starts playing or interplaying the dynamics across attribute and it starts predicting. What we will be doing, this is what data set, let us consider perhaps. I may be generating 50,000 sales record of my business, 50,000, or you can imagine even 1 lakh records or 1 lakh observation I am getting out of my business sales report in the year 2020 or in the year 2019. What I supposed to do is, I need to use these all the 1 lakh records for my machine to train. Learn from the data set. Machine starts learning from the data set only. That is why it is called machine learning. Algorithm just supports. Just it's a connection between the data and the machine. Algorithm, it's a kind of language to communicate between the data and the machine or hardware. Whenever we are trying to give sales prediction of 2020, I'm giving, for instance, when I am assuming that there is a person comes from Germany, the age of the person is so and so, salary of the person is so and so, my algorithm able to predict before even the person really makes a sales with me, I may able to predict what would happen. Or for the same or previous customer, I can able to judge whether the same customer will purchase with me or not in the calendar year 2020. Then testing the machine learning algorithm, this label we are not going to substitute. Your machine or your model will start predicting. This is called classification. This is a data set example for two class data set. We have no and yes. There are different data set you may be able to see in your project time. Multi-class variable also will play a role. For example, if you consider, but I'm categorizing customers into different category. Rarely purchasing, occasionally purchasing, never purchasing, cash always purchasing, something like that. If the frequency of the purchaser becomes more, always purchasing, I'm labeling. Then four category. then how can I classify when the new customer comes into these all attribute? Whether should I label that person as a casual customer or regular customer or occasional customer or something like that? Then it becomes multi-class algorithm or multi-class prediction. So you can work with two class also, you can work with three class also, or you can work with multi-class also. The moment the target variable is of categorical in nature or labeled with a verbal or labeled with a name, it's a nominal data. The moment it has some category, we need to call it as classification. Next. The moment we hear different scenario. There are two independent variable, month and rainfall, which can be treated as dependent variable in this case. This is simple case study. I want to understand how many umbrellas are sold out based on the month and rainfall of that particular locality. Then which are all the parameters or which are all the features can be termed as independent? Which are all the parameters can be termed as dependent? May I hear from you?
Hello.
Yeah, it's a simple scenario. There are three column A, B, C, month, rainfall and umbrella sold. With this scenario, which attribute or which column can be labeled as independent? Which column can be labeled as dependent?
Dependent is C and independent is B.
C is?
Dependent.
Yeah, dependent. A and B both are independent. Dependent.
Because due to of this so-and-so rainfall meters, the umbrellas will get sold. Right?
Exactly. Again, the same scenario. If you look at the dependent variable, it is of numerical or continuous data. It is termed as continuous data.
Okay.
When the moment the target variable is labeled with the continuous data, it's said to be predictive analytics. There are several ways to do predictive analytics. Predominantly in your stipulated outline curriculum, we will be discussing about linear regression. Yesterday we have seen under supervised learning, two major categories we have seen: linear regression, logistic regression. Logistic regression is for classification when the target variable is of categorical in nature. The moment target variable is of continuous in nature, we may need to apply linear regression or predictive analytics. This case is also meant for independent variable, but along with independent dependent variable, we are trying to interpret what kind of model we need to apply. The moment the target variable becomes categorical in nature, we may need to approach with classification model. The moment target variable is of continuous in nature, we need to approach with predictive model. One classical example widely used across all the business aspects is called linear regression. Next, the moment data is given, we may need to start understanding certain aspects. If you look at this data set, here there is a missing data. The country of the person is Spain, but I don't know the age. The country of the person is Germany, but I don't know the salary of that person. There are situations will arise, we may not be able to collect all the necessary information. Then in those situations, how can I handle this missing data? This is also a major aspect of data analytics. Should I truncate or should I fill with something? For treating this missing data, again, we have classical set of algorithms we'll be discussing back, but we need to look at that. Number one. Next, we need to look at outlier deduction. Next, we need to look at normal distribution. Before coming to these three topics, we need to understand what is univariate independent analysis. For example, looking at only country of this purchase order, I may need to draw a histogram. How many are from France? How many are from Spain? How many are from German? Which country starts purchasing with my online sales? Who is a main contributor of my profit? I may need to understand only through this column. It's said to be univariate analysis. Considering one variable at a time, individual variable is said to be univariate independent analysis. Similarly, if I start looking at the data, which age range, 10 to 20 years, 20 to 30 years, 30 to 40 year, 40 to 50 year, which age group starts purchasing with me a lot? Who is my business influencer? If I start looking at in that perspective, targeting the age group for the future promotional activity, this may be essential. Univariate analysis is essential. Similarly, if I start analyzing what is the range of salary influences my business, then I can target those salaried people. This is called digital marketing or promotional activity. For those purposes, the same data set, we may need to understand individually. That is called univariate analysis. Sometime univariate analysis required, sometime doesn't require. It's all context dependent. Next, we may need to go with measure of central tendency, mean, mode, median. Predominantly people used to call measure of central tendency. We will be touching upon this also in the forthcoming slide. If the central tendency doesn't give any inferences, immediately we may need to move upon dispersion or variability. Under dispersion, variability, range, interquartile range, these are all the standard deviation, variance calculation. These are all the way it helps. And again, we will be having situation when the central tendency fails towards the interpretation. At what situation we may need to rely on dispersion and variability, we'll be looking at case study. And other way we can analyze, just we can plot it in a graph. There are a variety of graphs, variety of visual plots available. I'll be introducing few more websites also for way of looking at data by your own self. Just change the data set, retain the same coding. It will give you the graphical representation of the data. So we can analyze the data with the support of central tendency, or we can analyze the data with the support of dispersion or variability. We can analyze the data with the support of graphs or exploratory analysis. Otherwise, technically, the buzzword used is exploratory data analysis. Before even going for this analysis, we may need to consider what is missing data or how to handle the missing data. What is outlier? What is normal distribution? Let us go towards these are all the six titles we'll be looking at in the forthcoming session. May I proceed?
Yeah, fine.
Now again, we are coming back with the same descriptive statistics, inferential statistics we have seen. Again, descriptive statistics, these are all considered to be descriptive statistics. The moment we find central tendency, dispersion variability, graph exploratory analysis, these all said to be descriptive. The moment we use estimation and hypothesis testing, again, two more buzzwords. So again, already we are with these three buzzwords. Again, two more buzzwords. Under inferential statistics, we may need to consider estimation, or we may need to consider hypothesis testing. Just be aware of this all. We will be discussing in the forthcoming slide, little bit elaborate. Estimators under inferential statistics. Point estimation, interval estimation. If you look at point estimation, finally we may do average or we may do something. We will deduce to one number, 620. We started deducing it into one number. The mean annual rainfall of Melbourne is 620 mm per year. Done. This is called point estimation, final conclusion. My sales value of 2019, $1 billion. Done. That is point estimation. Interval estimation. In 80% of all years, Melbourne receives between 440 mm to 800 mm rain. The moment we will start describing the range, the sales revenue of 2019 of my business, $50 billion to $100 billion. The moment I start describing, then it is said to be interval estimation. Right now, this understanding or notion is sufficient. Again, we will be solving some of the problems or looking into further. Next, coming to hypothesis testing. What is hypothesis testing? Here we may need to understand two notational mathematical notation, H0, HA. HA, it is addressed as null hypothesis. HA is addressed as alternative hypothesis. What it is, again, we will come to. Look at any investigation, we may need to formulate a statement. For example, the same health sector which I consider started discovering a new medicine, herbal medicine for lung cancer. I need to state the drug works, it has a real effect. Then I may need to say that null hypothesis H0. Alternative statement, I'm telling that the drug doesn't work. Any effect you saw was due to chance. There is no relationship between the drug administration and the cure in the patient. That is termed as alternative hypothesis. This statement we may need to formulate before even approaching the data or analyzing the data. Then how we are concluding, how we are taking decision upon either this is true or this is true is based on, again, statistical notion. This is initial assumption. Assumptions of two kind, it works well, it doesn't work well. Anything, for example, eating this food leads to obesity, eating this food doesn't lead to obesity. It could be any statement, but we may need to treat either with H0, the alternative we may need to treat with HA. This is statement formulation. Then how we are testing the test, it follows, these are all the sequences of steps. We may need to define what is my null hypothesis. We may need to define what is my alternative hypothesis. Then we may need to fix confidence interval. Statistically, we will be using three confidence interval. That what are all those confidence interval? Again, we will be looking into forthcoming slide. Then we need to look at decision rule. If the decision is above certain thing, we may need to accept either one of the hypothesis. If the decision is below certain estimated value, we may need to accept either one of them. Test statistic, take decision. Decision rule we may need to formulate. Test the statistic, whether it is less than the formulated value or above the formulated value. Accordingly, we may need to take decision whether we need to accept null hypothesis or we need to accept alternative hypothesis. The moment we accept this, naturally we are rejecting this. Or the moment we are rejecting this, naturally we are accepting this. So either way you can start understanding. Again, we may need to go a little bit deeper with the hypothesis testing. Today, a basic introduction or what to say, introduction of all the terminologies revolving around this analytics, we may need to be familiar. Coming back, the very first measure we started discussing is central tendency, dispersion, and exploratory data analysis. That order we will be moving on. When it comes central tendency, we use predominantly mean, mode, median. During our school education, we would have come across, these are all the terminologies. Mean, otherwise called, said to be an average. It is the easiest metric to understand and communicate. What is the average salary of this firm? The moment I come to know average salary of that particular industry, I may able to take declaration or I may able to judge salary of my own profile or salary of my neighbors or salary of my friends. So this mean signifies sometimes to understand better about the scenario or situation. Mean is prone to presence of outliers. Sometimes outliers plays adverse role or favor role. Let us consider what is outlier. This keyword we may need to consider a lot towards data science. What is outlier? For example, all of us have come across school education or college education. The moment I start averaging, what is a class average mark? There are two sections, Perhaps I can say section A, section B. Section A and section B, two section. I am calculating their average mark. This says that 65. Average of B section says that 82. What I mean to say outlier is the question mark. Section A, only one student obtained 2 marks. Remaining all students have obtained 80 marks. Whereas B section are 85 or 80 marks. Each and every student started obtaining the range between 80 to 85. Just because of looking at this average value, if I conclude A section doesn't work well, B section students are intelligent. This conclusion is misleaded by the outlier, this two. This two is said to be an outlier. Because of only one candidate, 2 marks, if I start doing average of perhaps 30 students, let us consider, if I start doing average of 30 students, it says me the score of the class is 65. But really, except this one candidate, all other candidates, 29 candidates are equally performing with B section. This is a kind of disturbance it will create, this outlier. Extremity or extreme situation is said to be outlier. Let us consider one more scenario. I'm finding out salary of our annual income of the family. I'm declaring the statement, if the annual income of the family is less than 10 lakhs, I'm giving fee discount. I'm giving some discount. If the family income goes above 10 lakhs, I don't give any discount for the student studies. In such situation, greater than, I'm considering two group again, A group, B group. Whereas in the B group, one person earns more than, I don't know how to pronounce these digits, I'm just adding crores. Just because of one student, if I start averaging, then it would lead to about 10,000. Then the entire group or entire region people may not able to get discount. Only less than 10,000 people or that group will get discount. By the situation, that outlier, that one person of that salary sits and disturbs the entire data set. This is another kind of outlier. Here, a smaller value creates, extreme smaller value creates disturbance towards interpretation or judging about people. Only one person earns multi-crore. This one person sits in the family of B group. This creates a lot of trouble in making judgment or decision making. This is termed as outlier. One more thumb rule, not all the time outlier will disturb the inferences of the model or accuracy of the model. Sometimes with outlier it works well, sometimes without outlier it works well. It's the duty of data scientists to deal with both retaining outlier analysis and eliminating outliers and do the analysis. And whether that outlier need to be retained or not to be retained, another question. It's all business situation. We may need to understand thoroughly what business case study we are getting. Depending upon the case study, we may need to consider whether outliers are need to be removed away or outliers are need to be retained. And if at all I am retaining, how that gives a result, how that affects my results of the prediction, how it improves my results, that all the role of data scientist. This outlier is a predominant, the predominant element of data analysis. That's over. Next, let's go back to median. We all know, given the data set, we may need to sort it in the either descending order or ascending order or increasing order or decreasing order. We need to find out the middle value of that sorted element. that middle value is treated as median. At time, mean alone required to infer something towards the data set. Median alone helps to infer something. It's all case dependent or situation dependent. Mode alone sometimes helps us infer something. What is mode? We all know. In a class, more than 10 students may be getting 65 marks. Then the mode of the class A is 65, because 10 students consistently are in a particular exam obtain 65 marks. There are other marks, maybe 47, 80, 91. Very few students, one student, two students only would have obtained. The highest mode of that class mark is 10. For the data, 65. Similarly, most of the cases we will be getting multimodal. What is multimodal is, in a same class, 10 more students would have obtained 70 marks. Or 9 students would have obtained 60 marks. So this is multimodal. Multiple instances repeated with multiple, what to say, multiple number of times. 10 students have got 65 in a class, 10 students have got 70 in a class, 9 students have got 60 in a class. So this is termed as multimodal. Shall I proceed, or any questions or anything need to be clarified? Suman, may I proceed?
Yeah, please.
Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
And is it possible to share this presentation?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
No, Brendan sir may be taking in charge of sending you this PPTs. Fine. That would be good, because how many of you participating, those details I'm not having anything else.
Fine.
Yeah, single point of contact between you and the entire
because we need the recording actually.
Yeah.
I will share the recording as well as the PPTs, don't worry.
Yeah, definitely. Now let's go back to, now we are talking so great about mean, mode, median. But there are circumstances, it will lead to worsen situation. If you look at this data set, I'm traveling by, auto. I got to know the first word. I'm traveling daily from my home to office by auto. It takes each and every day 7 hours journey, or 7 minutes, whatever. We can convert it into hours, whatever. 6 hours, 3 hours, 8 hours, 12 hours, 9 hours, something. From same source to destination, from my home to office, I'm traveling by office transport. Look at, there is a consistency. All the time, I'm taking 9 hours. Similarly, if I start traveling by own car, perhaps the day one I would have reached with a different route, 1 hour, different route, 3 hour, 5 hour, whatever. If we start calculating mean, median, mode of these three mode of travel, all the values signifies with 999. What we can conclude? Nothing we can conclude out of it. By this situation, central tendency fails giving something about the data. No more thought using central tendency. Absolutely flop. Central tendency will not help me at all. Although in the previous slide, we have seen a lot of stories how the mean helps me in predicting or taking judgment upon two classes, A section, B section, how median helps, how mode helps. But immediately we are moving towards another situation or case. None of these central tendency parameters giving me any inference, because if I start considering average of this, it says me 9. Average of this says me 9. Average of this says me 9. Then how can I conclude which kind of transportation, which mode of travel I supposed to further continue in my rest of the career? Now we need to stick to measure of dispersion, measure of variance. The moment central tendency failed, we need to move on with measures of dispersion. There are four ways we can calculate the measures of dispersion. Again, the question would be, should I calculate all the four? It's case dependent. No one can assure, no one can declare whether range is sufficient or all the four are required. It's all case dependent. But in general, measures of dispersions are majorly classified into four: range, mean deviation, standard deviation, variance. These are all the four ways we can calculate measures of dispersion. For the same situation or the scenario, how we are inferring, let us look at. What is measures of dispersion? We may need to look at through graphically. Measures of dispersion is more for this representation, pink color. Look at this graph, 0.5. Oh, yeah, 0.5. Look at this blue line. Measures of dispersion is too huge, 5.0. Next, measures of dispersion for the green, 1.0. Measures of dispersion for the red, 0.20. Which graph, you can look at parallelly the statistical inference and the graphical representation. Measures of dispersion calculated with the mu average and the standard deviation, sigma square. This is the formula we use generally for standard deviation. How this comes? It's again simple matter. Each and every point, how it varies from the mean and number of samples considered for the calculation. Simple. Then we may need to go for square root. Why we are doing square root? May I hear from you? Standard deviation, why we supposed to do square root? Why not this formula alone I can retype?
Once again, question.
Why we supposed to do square root? 1 by n sigma summation I equal to 1 to n xi minus mu the whole square. Why can't my formula without square root? Why I supposed to go for square root?
I think we have to relate to the I think population and sample, I believe.
Yeah. Why we are doing square here, the positive and the negative polarity will cancel each other. Sometimes we may get zero. That zero never ever infer something. That's the reason we are doing square for the difference. Each and every individual sample with the average deviation, how the deviation of the A section and B section, which I considered earlier. That is the number one answer we may need to understand. Most of the formula we'll be using square. Yeah, yeah. Even gradient descent, gradient calculation, we'll be looking at the square also.
Yeah, because we ended up in negative, correct.
Square root.
Because we ended up in negative, to make it positive, we'll square it up.
Yeah, that is for square root. Square. Square root, why do we do the square root? Is to bring the value to the smaller representation so that the comparative would become easier. If we don't use the square root, what would happen is the value would be different, varied. It gives a 348, this gives a 245, this gives a 410. We may not be able to compare how adjacent each other. What is the threshold we should keep? This 348 is much worse than 480. We cannot be able to claim. That is the reason we are taking square root. These are all the small phenomena we may need to understand, because most of the time the formulas which we use are similar kind of this imitation. Entirely we will be using probability, at time we will be using statistic, at time we are using probability. Mostly we will be using square root and average and square. Each phenomena, why we are going for average, why we are taking square, why we are doing square root, that underneath understanding is clear, means however the big formula we can able to understand it. Now let us come back to this dispersion. Look at which is having very, very smaller 0.2, that red line. this is what dispersion is very lesser. Which is opposite? Blue. Blue have got highest dispersion. This we may need to understand both statistically and graphically. Exploratory analysis is graphical. This is statistical analysis is numerical. Both way we may need to be able to understand. This is distribution with a different dispersion. Now let us go back. How we are approaching this problem with central tendency is the topic of discussion. The same case study we are continuing. This is a case study we consider for central tendency, mean mode, median mode, but we failed because all imitate same. How can I take conclusion? Nothing I can infer out of this. So that we started understanding what is measures of dispersion. There are four ways to measure, which we are going to use. Let us discuss. Out of that standard deviation we started considering, that standard deviation always signified with mu and sigma. Mu represents the height of the graph. Sigma represents the breadth of the graph. X-axis and y-axis are represented by mu and sigma. These two are the predominant component considered towards standard deviation. The formula which is used for standard deviation is this. Now let's go back to interquartile range. I will come back a little bit back. Now same data set, nothing else changed. Going by auto, going by office transport, going by own car. If we start calculate mean median mode, already we have seen this. For the same data set, we are calculating standard deviation and variance. Standard deviation using the previous formula, similar kind of or a little bit different formula we may be having for variance. That's it. If we substitute the data towards variance and data standard deviation, the obtained information is 3.0, or obtained inferences are 9.2, 0.0, 0.0, 4.9, 24.0. Now my question is, which mode of transport I need to proceed further throughout my career? By looking at standard deviation and variance. The first column is traveling by auto, second column is traveling by office transport, third column is traveling by my own car. Which one we may need to consider based on standard deviation and variance? This is standard deviation. Going by office transport, there is no deviation, no variance. By looking at the data itself, we can understand there is a consistency maintained by this mode of travel. Lot of inconsistency, maybe due to the traffic or maybe due to the route, we don't know. This also possesses lot of inconsistency, maybe due to the route or traffic or we don't know the time which we travel. But if you look at office transport, the consistency is maintained. That is, looking at the data itself, we can declare. If not, if you look at low variance, low deviation, then whichever gives low deviation, low variance, I suppose to stick to that. So in this scenario, I may need to stick to office transport towards my travel. This is a conclusion out of this case, measure of central tendency. Next, another situation, neither central tendency will give solution for certain cases, nor the dispersion or measure of dispersion also will give the solution. Look at this scenario. I'm not good in watching cricket, or even I don't know anything in and out of cricket, but I can understand this data. Let us assume that the player, cricket player Dravid, the score or run whatever of different matches I'm considering. Similarly, Sehwag, I'm considering different scores of this player. If we calculate mean, it says same. If I calculate median, it says same. Then how can I declare which player is better performer, which player is not a better performer? Then the moment mean and median comes similar, If we calculate dispersion, this won't work out for this data. We may need to stick to coefficient of variation. This is the formula between the standard deviation and the mean. We are flipping the use of formula, that's it, and multiply with 100. It gives 24%, 84%. What this signifies? Wherever Dravid plays, whenever Dravid plays, whichever the match he plays, there is a variation or there is a difference with only 24%. Look at Sehwag, 84% variation exists. This data itself can speak. Look at the score of the Sehwag is 1, whereas the highest score of the Sehwag is 300. When we look at David's data set, there is no such highest deviation. The range, if we calculate, it has very minimal. The range, if we calculate, it has more. So in such situation, how to identify consistent performer or good performer, whether the performer is good or bad, how consistent he is. This is a match of different year, different location. This is a match of different year, different location. Based on this data set, how can I conclude he is a consistent player? How I can conclude that Dravid is a consistent player? Because variation is only 24%. The Sehwag have got highest variation. There is no consistency I could see among Sehwag. Evidently, the data itself says he got score 1, whereas this match he got 300. Perhaps maybe due to his health sickness or anything may be the reason, but there is no consistency. This situation we may need to approach with coefficient of variation. We need to understand the data set. We need to understand the problem statement, what we are interested to. Here we are trying to find out who is more consistent. Here we are trying to find out which route I need to follow. The moment I join to a new office, I'm trying a trial with 10 days or 30 different days with all the different modality. I'm making a note of it. What is the number of hours I'm traveling from source to destination? Then out of that, I'm calculating mean, mode, median. I couldn't infer anything. Then I'm moving to measure of central tendency. Yet, yes, it gives something. Here the scenario is different. Here the scenario is different. So depending upon the use case, we may need to approach with statistics. Now, graphical representation. This is another way of understanding the data. First, we may need to understand the data, how it varies, how it is similar, how it is relates each other. These are all the insights we may need to consider. One such insight we can obtain through histogram or bar graph. Next, we can get an insight through pie chart. Next, we can get an insight through line graph. Again, we'll be discussing this little bit detail with the Python code, how we can do this, why we need to do this all. Sometimes these are all the parameters, central tendency, measures of dispersion, mean deviation, standard deviation, interquartile range. These all may give some time supporting evidences. At time, graphical also plays a vital role than the numerical value. At time, most of the users or most of the analysts tend to observe a key point through graphical than numerical. That is another beauty of graphical representation. So yet another graphical representation, this is histogram. There is a slight variation here. Bar graph has a category between 10 to 20 years, 20 to 35 years, something like that. Histogram, there is no category. We will be plotting the entire data which is given and we are taking inference. Next, this example for line chart, OG curve. These are all the way, much more or many more plots are available depending upon the use case, what we are trying to infer, why we are trying to infer. Depending upon it, we may need to use the suitable graph. Now, let us go back to outlier. Again, I have given two scenario. One is mark, the person scoring with 2 marks, and one of the millionaires sits in the group. That data disturbs the entire community for not having the promotion or discounts. Because of one person, if I start calculating average, then that says different. Mean without Bill Gates, mean with Bill Gates. What is the value? See, the moment I include Bill Gates into any, even his own company, his own Microsoft, if I include his salary, what would happen? I may not able to take any judgment out of that salary pattern of that firm or that particular IT industry. I may not able to conclude anything. The moment I remove Bill Gates' salary, I may able to conclude something, what is the salary pattern of that IT industry. So this is the role play of outliers. Sometimes we may need to treat, sometimes we may need to remove that all. We may need to discuss when really we look into the data. Look at this data. This data is said to be outlier. All are likely close to each other, but this sits somewhere beyond the range. This person seems to be something extreme when compared to this entire community. That is called outlier. Outlier we can find out through various methods using box plot, scatter plot. So that also we will be discussing. Outlier detection also we'll be discussing. Next, the major parameter which I said, normal distribution. Hope you may be remembering. This is what we are trying to discuss. Outlier detection, missing data, normal distribution. These three are predominantly used during data pre-processing or data cleaning. That is what we are trying to understand. Missing value, we haven't touched it upon. We started looking at outlier. Next, the major topic or important topic, we can say in terms of machine learning or deep learning or in terms of statistics, normal distribution. What is normal distribution? Look at this graph. Any data set, if you try to plot, if it resembles the bell curve, then it is said to be normal distribution. This is making you to visualize or imagine something better. All the statistical tool, all the machine learning algorithm, using the theoretical phenomena or theoretical myth called the data should be normally distributed. If the data is normally distributed, that suits well for all the statistical application, all the machine learning models, that is a myth says. But based on this normal distribution only, all the formulas are designed, all the models are built. This normal distribution, otherwise called Gaussian distribution, it's very simple. Anybody gives you the data, you may need to plot it. There are several other ways also available to identify whether my data is normally distributed or not. One such way, easiest way or simplest way, we may need to plot graphically. The moment it resembles like this bell shape, it is said to be normal distribution or Gaussian distribution or bell curve. How the distribution should be? 80% of my 68% of my data should sit within this range or within this dispersion or within this standard deviation, SD. 95% of my data should sit within this dispersion or standard deviation. The remaining data should sit here. There are few data can go beyond this band. That is not a consideration. This also we can calculate using Python code, whatever. Either we can plot or we can calculate the distribution of the data set or standard deviation of the data. Most of the time, 68% of the data falls into one standard deviation, second standard deviation, and third standard deviation. Then we agree that it is, or nearby, if we get also, we can declare that it is normally distributed. The rule which is called 68-99.7 rule. Normal distribution, otherwise numerically called as 68-99.7 rule. This starts with negative infinity to positive infinity. In general, when we consider the data, never it will fall into infinity. It will end up with some negative value, it will end up with some positive value. Not necessarily negative also should be there in the data. Within the positive data also, it will resemble the normal curve. Within the negative data also, it will resemble that normal curve. There is another, how we can understand normal distribution. Number one, look at the histogram. If it doesn't resemble the bell shape, it is not normally distributed. We can compute mean, median, mode. All those three values should be nearby each other, should be similar. Maybe a little deviation, 100 number, depending upon the value which we have time. It should be very near to each other. Then it is normally distributed. or we can find out the standard deviation. As I said, 68.98, 95, 99.7 rule. There is another way. We can use probability plot or scatter plot. Based on that, we can conclude. There is another method called normality test, Kolmogorov-Smirnov. This is highly famous, or most of the data analysts will be using this Kolmogorov-Smirnov. This test says some value range. If the range of the result, if we obtain, we may need to fit into that theory, what the theory he says. If that theory is matched, then it is into normal, or else it is not normal. Again, it is categorized into three representation or three buzzwords. Again, it makes us to learn. This blue is set, this red. Red is positive kurtosis. One more measure of identifying whether data is normally distributed or not is kurtosis. The value which we obtain, it's again one formula. If we substitute the value to that formula, the result should be 3. If with that 3 is obtained, normal distribution, the result is obtained with 3, it is said to be normally distributed. Otherwise, it is called negative kurtosis, positive kurtosis. This middle one is called normal distribution. This is another way of measuring normal distribution. Normal distribution alone we can address for a day. But right now, we stick to three methods. One is graphical method, or else standard deviation computation, 68.95, 99.7 rule, or kurtosis, calculating kurtosis. So again, Python helps us with the code. The moment we use or substitute the data, it starts finding out the kurtosis. Normal, next question, normal distribution is applicable for an attribute or for the entire data set. We have looked at the data now. Whether it is applicable for the entire data set or for an attribute, particular single attribute. For example, I'm talking from the beginning normal distribution. Let us consider this data set. Should I apply normal distribution for the entire data set or for a particular attribute?
I think only for the particular attribute.
Yeah, particular attribute, only for the numerical value. Age, normally distributed or not. Naturally, 0 age person, 2 age person will not purchase with me. Never ever we will send a kid less than 10 years to a shop or for the online browsing or online websites. However, if we start distributing whatever the age we have, among the data set, it will be imitating a bell curve. The moment if it imitates normally or normality, then we can consider for data model. How I said outlier, whether to be retained or not, for the better accuracy or for the better prediction or for the better model, it's all dependent on the case study. Same is applicable for normality also. We may need to try a model with normality. We may need to try a model without normality. Which works well, nobody can predict. But these are all the pre-processing we may need to do, we may need to understand. If the data, given data set is not normal, next question, if it is not normal, should I proceed with that data or that attribute or not? It's a natural question. No need to truncate. There are different measures, ways to bring it back to normality. I'm just introducing today, Z score, we can use it for normality. Min-max algorithm, we can use for normality. Log transformation, we can use it for normality. And a few more also. There is a way to bring back to normality. We need to convert it into normality. Then we need to build the model. Or at time, no need to convert it into normality, we can build the model. That all during hands-on session, we'll be discussing a little. And if the graph is not normal, then what it would be? If it is not like this, then what it would be? It's termed as skewed data. If the tail is of positive side, positive skew. If the tail is of negative side, negative skew. How we calculate this Q. The moment we plot, we can able to look at the graph, it starts imitating this resemblance. Again, how we can calculate through central tendencies. This is the equation or this is the relationship between mean, median, mode when the data is of negative skewed in nature. This is the relationship among mean, median, mode when the data is of positively skewed. So looking at the mean, median, mode itself, we can conclude whether data is of positively skewed or negatively skewed. Or by looking at the graphical representation also, we can conclude whether data is of which is skewed. Again, skewed, the moment we obtain, it's not normal. Either you can test for normality or you can test for skewness. I just to recap, almost it's 9 o'clock. We may able to touch upon the practical session, may not. Database, data may come from database, data may come from data warehouse. The moment data applies with three words, three V, velocity, veracity, variety, it's a big data. We may not touching upon the big data, only a data we are touching upon. Analytics of three in nature, descriptive analytics, predictive analytics, prescriptive analytics. These are just a terminology we may need to be aware. When the data is, when to use ANOVA, when to use regression, these all will be discussing in the forthcoming sessions. Visual analytics, anything which we start analyzing through graphical representation, it's a visual analytics. Information system software, it's a kind of data mining and sorting. Outlier, that's what we have seen. It's a kind of recap. Outlier, we would have understood. One particular instance will be differing, extremely differing among the entire set or the population. Dependent, independent variable, types of data we have seen, categorical, ordinal, interval, ratio. What is business analytics? Applying both descriptive analysis and the inferential analysis, we may need to deduce something or infer something. Upon that inference, we may need to take decision towards the organization. It is ODMP. Mathematical models, again, deterministic model, non-deterministic model. Whatever we discuss with the set curriculum for you, it's all of deterministic model. We are not touching upon non-deterministic model. The moment non-determinism exists, stochastic or probability. Most of the real cases, 50% belongs to non-deterministic model. 50% only resembles with the deterministic model. All the time deterministic model will give or will work within the condition, boundary conditions. Stochastic model, any moment you start using random, it's one of the example of stochastic model. Using Excel, using Python also, we can generate random data. Those all working under the principle called stochastic model. However, it is stochastic model, it starts following normal distribution. Risk management and mitigation, highly uses stochastic model. Especially stock market prediction. Deterministic model will not work out. In the stock market prediction or financial sector, 50% of the time people are using stochastic model. Stochastic model, there are a few case studies. Then perhaps before meeting, you may need to undergo or you just to give you a casual glance for these types of distribution. Most of the time we'll be using normal distribution. But we cannot stick to normal distribution alone for all the cases and circumstances or business use case. At time, we may need to look at Bernoulli, uniform, binomial, Poisson, and exponential distribution. So just to give you quick glance, most of the time, we will not be touching upon these all in this curriculum, only the normal distribution. So you can have a quick reading. So next to the representation of symbol and what we are doing. Again, it's a kind of recap only I'm doing. Right skewed. The tail is of right side. Then right skewed. The tail is of left side. Left skewed. Looking at the data also, you can see how it is. How it the relationship, whether it is less than or greater than between mean, mode, median. We can say whether it is rightly skewed or left skewed. Estimation we have discussed. Null hypothesis, point estimation, interval estimation. So interval estimation, we may need to touch upon a little bit, elaborate also, but however, the interval is discussed with one standard deviation, two standard deviation, three standard deviation. Here we will be using 90% confidence interval, 95%, 99%. This little bit different flip we may need to apply. Range, interquartile range, these all data cleaning and data preparation, missing value treatment, and exploratory data analysis. These are all going to be your tomorrow's agenda. Data pre-processing, exploratory data analysis. Today we looked into elaborately about descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. Tomorrow we will be looking into data pre-processing, exploratory data analysis with hands-on. A little theory we may need to perhaps start first 20 minutes. Immediately we can move on to hands-on. This is a tomorrow's agenda I'm just sharing with you. So anything we start, we may need to start with gratitude. Gudovan Rosam is the person introduced to Python language or programming in 1991. He is a great person, rocking till date with all the domain. Python started taking a lead. We may need to start with gratitude by looking at Gudovan Rosam. With this, I conclude today's session, and tomorrow we will be going back to Python and exploratory data analysis, data pre-processing. Do you have any questions? You can ask me. Guys, are you there? Yes. Do you have any questions?
No, actually, I should go through again all these things. If I have any doubts, I will ask you tomorrow. Let me go through everything, recap once everything.
Okay.
Whatever, I will also look it and I'll note down the doubts.
Okay. Fine. Thank you all. Good night.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Yeah, bye. Bye, Girish. Bye, Suma.
Bye, sir.
Bye. 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 I love you.